God, we thank you and we praise you for gathering us here. Bless us with your Holy Spirit. Bless us today and bless us every day. Bless the words of our mouths and bless the thoughts of our minds. May all that we do and all that we say be holy and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Through Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen. So as many of you know, I was just in San Antonio from Monday till Friday, and I was listening to preachers, arguably some of the best preachers in the entire United States and Canada. But there's this one funny story. So one of the presenters who's been everything, he's been a pastor, he's been a dean, he's been a bishop in the United Methodist Church. I mean, he's done it all. And so his name is Will Williman, which always makes me laugh. Will Williman. And so he was getting up and he was speaking. And before he began his lecture, so he had already preached to us, and then he was beginning his lecture. And before he began, he told us about how he was talking to somebody about how he was going to the Festival of Homiletics. And that person said, "Oh, what is it?" And he's like, "Oh, well, it's a festival of preaching where we go and we spend the week and we listen to people preach and we listen to people talk about preaching. I mean, literally about 9 hours a day, we listen to people preach or talk about preaching." And that person looked at him and responded by saying, "That sounds like hell." I thought it was hilarious. Of course, you know, we all erupted into laughter because the truth is that we were so excited to be there. I mean, with some of our favorite preachers, I mean, Adam Hamilton, who I love, I got there so early so I could go sit as close to the front as possible to listen to him talk for an hour and a half, 2 hours, something like that. And so for us, it was kind of heavenly, but it is quite funny that for some people, that would be their version of hell. But somewhere in the beginning of the week, I think that it could have been Rob Bell, who you've heard me talk about a lot. I can't quite remember because everybody kind of merged together. But somewhere in the beginning of the week, someone talked about how difficult it can be for us as pastors to talk to our people about God's protection. Because what we want to be able to do is we want to be able to tell all of our people that from the moment that you are baptized, from that moment that the sign of the cross is sealed on your forehead and you are baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, we want to be able to tell you from that very moment that you are sealed with the Holy Spirit. We want to be able to tell you that from that very moment you are sealed from the Holy Spirit and you will be protected and you will be protected every day of your life. That is what we want to be able to tell you. But the truth is that it doesn't work that way, does it? That's not exactly how it works. I mean, we just read from John chapter 14 where Jesus promised his disciples that the Holy Spirit would stay with them always, where they would never be orphaned, that the Holy Spirit would always be with them. But then look what happens to most of the disciples. Most of the disciples never turned 40 or 45, assuming that they were all about the age of Jesus when he did his ministry, because all of them are killed. Most of them, if not all of them, end up being killed. So even these disciples who Jesus said to them that the Holy Spirit will be with you always, you will never be orphaned. Even the disciples ended up facing death at a young age. The hard thing for many of us to understand is that just because the Holy Spirit is with us, and just because the Holy Spirit resides inside of us, that does not mean that bad things are not going to happen. Yes, we will never, ever be alone. We have that promise as long as we keep the commandments of God, as long as we keep the commandments to love the Lord our God and to love our neighbor, then we will never be alone. But the truth is that evil still exists. No matter how much we might try to say that, you know, eternal optimists like myself say, "Oh, evil doesn't exist." I mean, it does exist. Just turn on the news. Evil is still out there. And truth be told, evil isn't just still out there. It's inside here as well, isn't it? Evil still lives within each and every single one of us. Now, before I dig into our text a little bit more, I want to tell you about one of our preachers. And his name is Reverend Anthony Bailey. No, I had never heard of him before, so he was not one that I was like super duper excited to go see. I just went because each time you choose, there's two different locations. You get to choose between a preacher, and I was like, "Oh, okay, this guy's from Canada. I'm gonna go check him out." So I went to go see Reverend Anthony Bailey. He is an Episcopal priest from Ottawa, Canada, and he was recently in the news. And he was in the news because even though he serves a primarily white congregation, which might even be entirely white, he is black, as you can see from his picture, and so he was targeted because he is the pastor. And his church, the Episcopal Church, and also a mosque and a synagogue were targeted with racist graffiti from a teenager who I think was about 16 or 17 years old, who went and targeted the buildings with all these, you know, swastikas and racist graffiti all over the buildings. Now, of course, what most people would want to do is, you know, the police caught him. Okay, good, you caught him, go lock him up. right? That's, I mean, he had committed enough crimes. That's what most people would want to do. But instead, what Reverend Anthony Bailey did is he and the imam got together, and they met at his church, and they invited this young, disturbed teenager to come and to meet them. Instead of just locking him up, you know, he's got this demented mind that's been swayed towards all this terrible, evil stuff. They wanted to try to build a bridge. They wanted him to come and to meet them and to talk to them and to hear from him. So their response was not a response of anger, but their response was a response of love. Now, unfortunately, the teenager chose not to come and to meet with Reverend Bailey and with the imam. But you know what happened? Two members of that teenager's family have since started attending Reverend Bailey's church. They were so swayed by how much love he had, by how he responded with such love and with such grace, that they just had to go to that church and find out what that message was all about. Now I want to tell you his backstory. Now look, isn't he like the sweetest looking guy in the world? And he really is. I mean, you hear him talk. He is just about the sweetest thing in the whole wide world. Well, he also, when he told us that story, he also told us his backstory. Now, unfortunately, you know, the reason why he responded immediately with such love is because he's far too familiar with being targeted by racism. Now, what happened was years ago, before he even entered into seminary, he and his brother were in Montreal, you know, they're Canadians, and so they were in Montreal. And it was evening, and his brother had just gotten out of something, and the two of them were walking down the street in Montreal. By the way, who spent a lot of time in Montreal before, you know? Always seems like a decently safe place. Well, they're walking down the street in Montreal, and then this car comes by and pulls over and starts yelling all these racist slurs at them. And, you know, they're disturbed, but then the car goes and takes off, so they think they're okay. But then all of a sudden, the car comes back with more people in it. With more men in it who are, again, yelling racist things, this time they get out of the car and they have knives in their hands. And they attack Reverend Bailey and his brother. And they stabbed his brother in the heart. And he held his brother in his arms while he died. While he bled to death. So when people wonder how he could respond immediately with such love, and with such grace, how he could see this young boy who's being pulled into this world of evil, you know, this world of complete evil. He sees this young boy who's being pulled into that, and he wants to do everything to pull him back. The reason that he's trying to build this bridge, the reason that he tried to bring that kid into his church, and he's still trying, the reason he's trying to reach out to that young man is because he wants to pull him back to the Holy Spirit. He wants to show him the Holy Spirit. He wants to help him change. He doesn't want him to live this demented life for his entire, you know, life. He wants to bring him to good. Now, with this story in your mind, let's again think about our text that we just read from John chapter 14. Now in our text we read from the Gospel of John that Jesus is assuring his disciples, he's reassuring his disciples, telling them that even though he is going to die, even though his life is going to come to an end, first that he's going to return to the Father so that they don't need to be overwhelmed by grief, but he also reassures them that they will never be alone, that he's not going to leave them orphaned, that he's just not going to leave them out there alone for the same thing to happen to themselves right away. He says to them that he is going to send them an advocate that is a spirit of truth, and that advocate will live within them and among them. He promises them that they will not be orphaned. They will not be alone. This Holy Spirit, which we know is the third part of the Trinity, you know, God the Father and Jesus the Son and then the Holy Spirit, this third part of the Trinity is still a part of God, and this part of God is going to come and to be with them always until the end of the age so that they will not be alone. But Jesus warns them that this Spirit will not be within everyone. I caught this more this time when I read this chapter than I normally do. How he's really warning them that the Holy Spirit will not be in everyone. Everyone will not see or hear or feel the Holy Spirit because, as he says, there's this ruler of the world. You know, there's this evil. There's this force of evil in the world. And some people will be so swayed by the force of evil that they will be unable to hear the Holy Spirit. They will be unable to feel the Holy Spirit. And so he warns his disciples that there is still going to be good and evil in the world, which they were very familiar with. But he told them that if they keep his commandments, which Jesus makes clear throughout the Gospels, are to love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself, whether you like your neighbor or loathe your neighbor, to love them as yourself. He said if we as his disciples keep those commandments, then the Holy Spirit will take root in our lives and will live within us. But here's the tricky thing. If we look through the beginnings of the early church, the Acts of the Apostles, that's the book that comes after John in your Bible, but really it's the continuation of the Gospel of Luke. So if we look in the book of Acts, we notice that there, you know, if you are paying attention to what's happening with how the Holy Spirit is working, the Holy Spirit gives us strength and wisdom, but it does not give us strength and wisdom to help ourselves. Have you ever noticed that? Look at what happens throughout the book of Acts. If you go home, read through the book of Acts. The Holy Spirit does not give us the strength and the wisdom to help ourselves. Instead, the Holy Spirit gives us the strength and the wisdom and the power to help others. It gives us the strength to help others. It gives us the power to help others. It gives us the words and the wisdom that we need to help others. The Holy Spirit is not just something that comes in and kind of surrounds us and protects us and helps us, even though it does in times. Instead, the Holy Spirit gives us the power to protect and to help and to care for other people. So Reverend Bailey, moving to forgive that racist graffiti-slinging teenager, was led to do so by the Holy Spirit. And we, when we are led to speak for the downtrodden, when we are led to lift up those who have been put down, when we are led to help those who are in need, we are led to do that by what? The Holy Spirit. Now, the Gospel of John makes it clear that there's good and that there's evil in the world. It makes it abundantly clear, even more so than the other Gospels. This is something that the Gospel of John really targets. But then we have this other preacher. You're going to hear about some of these other preachers throughout the next 2 months, so just prepare yourselves. There's this other preacher, Reverend Otis Moss III. He's the one who took over for Reverend Jeremiah Wright at Trinity UCC in Chicago when Reverend Wright retired. Well, Otis Moss III, he preached, and honestly, he was hands down one of the best preachers I've ever heard in my life. Now, I told my mom that yesterday, and she was pleasantly surprised because she said when he came to the Massachusetts conference to speak for at their annual meeting, they're all kind of a little disappointed. They heard some amazing things for him, and he was okay, but they expected him to be great. And I told her, I was like, well, when he preached, he used Star Wars, and it was quite clear that he loved Star Wars. I mean, he loves Star Wars, and so he was on fire throughout the whole entire sermon, but I think it was easy enough, because when this guy enters talking about Star Wars, I mean, he just seemed to be in heaven. But what he did when he talked about Star Wars is he explained this whole, phenomenon of the Holy Spirit at work in the world and evil at work in the world so very well by using Star Wars. Now, is anybody here a Star Wars fan? Okay, a couple? Yeah, a couple? So we had more in the first service, but I told everybody that when I grew up, I had an older brother, and he watched Spaceballs, which is the comedy version, just as much as he watched Star Wars, and so in my mind, we're all one. So, if you don't know what Spaceballs is, that won't be funny, but I don't know. I always think Darth Vader is that guy with that, skinny little guy with that funny little voice. Apparently, that's from Spaceballs. But he explains the whole entire phenomenon of good and evil so well using Star Wars. Because in Star Wars, and forgive me, those of you who know this well, if I get this wrong, but in Star Wars, there's apparently this force. force, and this force is at work in the world, and there are these Jedis, and these Jedis are these people who can feel the force, and the force has a light side, and it has a dark side, and this force is at work pulling them in the world. So Darth Vader, who is actually a Jedi, just like Luke Skywalker, but Luke Skywalker's on the good side, whereas Darth Vader's, you know, gone to the bad side, and all that crazy stuff. But this is the best way to explain how the Holy Spirit works in the world. So in the world, even in all of us, we have all this battle going on within each and every single one of us. Even if we want to think evil is just out there, let's face it, evil takes root in our own lives too. So the way that evil and the Holy Spirit works is that it's the same. I'll try to line myself up with the screen. So let's say that the good side, the light side, is over here, and the dark side is over there. Well, the light side is the Holy Spirit, and we're all like Jedis, and the Holy Spirit is always trying to pull us and pull us and pull us, and the Holy Spirit is always trying to pull us. The Holy Spirit is that voice that we feel with inside of us saying, go and do good. Go and speak out for those who need you. Go and help those who are hungry. You know, feed those who are hungry. Clothe those who are naked. That's the Holy Spirit, the force of the Holy Spirit pulling us, saying, come on. Join the God team. You know, come on. Come and do good. But on the other side, we're all of us in this whole entire world, it's like we're in the middle of being pulled. And on the other side, there's the force of evil, which in the Gospel of John, he calls the ruler of this world, which, you know, as Sue House mentioned after the first service, that's kind of scary a little, you know, sometimes, you know. And there's this evil in the world, this force of evil in the world that's also pulling us always, saying, it's okay. It doesn't matter if you're going to hurt somebody when you do this. It doesn't matter if what you're going to do, you know, stabbing somebody in the heart is going to end their lives because it gratifies you. It doesn't matter if you steal a little. It doesn't matter if you jump in with all that violence going on in the world. It doesn't matter if you tear people down. It's okay. That's what this other side says. And we're all kind of like Jedis, which is kind of a cool thing, I guess, right? Where's our lightsabers, though? But, you know, we're all kind of like Jedis, and we're being pulled from one side to the other. Now, I want to tell you one more story quickly, and that's a story where, I mean, at the beginning of May, remember how there was all that flooding going on in the South? Where, I mean, and I don't know if it's still going on, but there was all that flooding going on in the South. And you may have seen this in the news, but there was a story in this video in the news, because this was all caught on camera, where there's this family with two young children, and they were in their truck, and mom and dad and two young children, and they were driving, trying to get away from the flooding, and then all of a sudden the flooding came and swept them up and flipped their truck upside down and left them upside down under the water with their four-month-old and their 18-month-old buckled in the back and mom and dad stuck in the front. Scariest moment. I mean, I'm sure that they all thought that their lives were going to be over. But then there were all these strangers who just felt, you know, empowered by the Holy Spirit to come and to help. And these strangers, they trudged through the flooded waters, which seriously came up to their waist. They trudged through the flooded waters. All of these different men, they come through all from different places, and they just start, you know, going through the water, and they break through the glass, and they hear the parents say, "Don't worry about us. Get the kids." And first they get that 18-month-old out, and then they get that 4-month-old out, and then there just happens to be somebody there who knows how to do CPR on the baby and resuscitate that baby. And then they even get the parents out, all the while somebody who's off on the side, they're somehow videotaping this because everybody's hands, there's already tons of people helping, and somebody else on the side is just praying and praying and praying and praying, and they just don't stop praying. They're saying, "Please, Lord Jesus, help them. Please, Lord Jesus, save them." The whole entire time. They were all led by the Holy Spirit, which gave them courage and strength to do things that maybe they shouldn't have been able to do. If you watch them in the video, you wonder, how is this possible? How are they going to free those people? How are those people in that truck not dead yet? How is this possible? Somehow, by the Holy Spirit, these people are led to go and to save the lives of all four members of this family. who are all four of them alive again, alive today, because of the Holy Spirit leading those strangers, giving them the strength that they need to help those who needed them desperately. Friends, the same Holy Spirit that lived within the disciples and gave them courage to do, you know, God knows what, even in the face of death. That same Holy Spirit that lived within Reverend Bailey and gave him the courage that he needed to, you know, respond with love, even when he might want to respond with anger. That same Holy Spirit that lived within those rescuers and saved the lives of those families is the same Holy Spirit that lives within inside you and me. And that same Holy Spirit is always taking root in our lives and calling us and urging us and moving us to do that what is right and that is right and that is holy and that is good. All we have to do is listen to that voice. Feel that pull. Move towards the Holy Spirit. And we can participate in the kingdom of God in ways that we never would have imagined. Let us join in a moment of prayer. Good and gracious God, we ask that you pour your Holy Spirit upon us now. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Enter into us now. Enter into us and give us the courage and the strength that we need to resist the evil that is in this world. Come, Holy Spirit, come, empower us and fill us and sustain us today and every day. Come, Holy Spirit, come and bless us with your power and your strength. Give us the wisdom that we need to speak up for those in need. Give us the strength that we need to help those who need our help. Come, Holy Spirit, come and bless us today and every day, so that we can be your force at work in this world. And we pray this in every prayer through Christ Jesus our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.